doesn't make a bit of difference. They're gone way before you can say, you start. And children's church will be, and Josiah's already cleared the back room. We're in Hebrews this morning. We're going to trick them one of these days. I got some ideas up my sleeve. We're in Hebrews, as I said, in chapter 3. I've got some great ideas. You know they have fun back there, those kids in the kids' church? They love going to Sunday school class. I don't know whatever happened. I'm not bitter about this or resentful in any way, but I don't remember ever having fun in Sunday school. Well, I don't know. Maybe I did. I just don't remember it. But they do. You need to see the loot those kids come out with. They come out with candy bars, fishing poles. They got a fishing pole back there in Sunday school class. And they got Mrs. Price. I never had a teacher like Mrs. Price in Sunday school and in junior church. You know, my teachers, I was afraid of my teachers. So, anyway, I'm not angry about it. I don't envy these children one bit, but I do think that we should lash out a little bit and have fun in church sometime just to get back at them. So y'all game for that? Be okay if we have a good time sometime? We're gonna start having Brother Al lead us in kids' songs, you know, with hand motions. Mrs. Dolan suggested that. It's a great suggestion. And Brother Al's the perfect guy to really do it, actually. So, that's not even picking on you, Brother Al, is it? Not yet. So he got, yeah, how many of you are witnesses last Sunday morning? I didn't pick on Brother Al one bit.
Generation X is characteristic of that.
It's a characteristic, lack of respect for authority.
Adult, yes.
No, not adult, authority. See? So.
Elders.
The Bible talks about elders, right? Authority for elders, yeah. Wow. Is there a little resentment from the baby boomer in the crowd?
You forgot baby busters.
What are baby busters?
Then there's busters.
Where are the busters?
Gen X. Then there's
millennials. I didn't know about the busters.
Z
is Obama a buster?
I don't know, but you're a buster.
Am I?
Yeah, Alan's a buster. You're a buster.
Okay. Mike, we're busters, buddy. Good word, right? That has nothing to do with the scripture. We are going to be in the Word of God here in a minute. Let me tell you something. I enjoy joking and having a good time. But I think some things ought to be serious, and we can still be happy about being serious, can't we? But one thing that I am very serious about at all times is the Word of God. And this book, my friend, is the most amazing book that you'll ever open. I have found, because of what it says and because of the witness of the Holy Spirit, I found that this book, the Bible, has no mistakes in it. You may have met someone before that tells you that there are errors in the Scripture, and it's interesting that they'll make a statement like that, but they won't show you what the mistakes in the Bible are. Now, you can Google and try to find some, and I dare you to. Bring those mistakes to me, and I'll show you what the Word of God says, and you'll find out that those who think the Scripture has errors are mistaken about that. This book is perfect, and it's only perfect because it comes from God, and that's amazing. Now, if you think about this, my friend, if you really understand what it means, that God, who is eternal, God who is so powerful that He created the world, the universe, has spoken to us in His Word by His Son, Jesus Christ. You'll have a reverence and a respect for this book. And I hope that this morning that you understand that it is with reverence and respect and with a respect for the absolute authority of this book that we open it here this morning. Let me just state this to you so you know where I'm coming from. I believe that the Bible says it, that it's true. And if I disagree with it, I believe that the error is with me. I love the song about the blessed old book that they sang, and they say, if when you read it, you find there's something wrong with you. And that's the truth about it. I love the words of that song because I found that. I found, that doesn't measure up. And then I realized, yeah, I sure don't. And when I get corrected, I found out God's Word works. I believe God's Word is the truth, but I found this. I have never obeyed it and found it to be wrong. I've always found that it was a miraculous, supernatural book. This Bible, this book, is what we're all about in our church. Matter of fact, our church's motto is where God's Word is magnified above all. Our theme verses, part of it's over here, Psalm 138:2, and the second part of it is, for Thou hast magnified Thy Word above all Thy name. And God holds this book up, important truth. Let me just say to you this morning, if you reject that the Bible is God's Word, You cannot escape the understanding that there's a God. And if you reject the Bible as God's Word, you have no way of knowing who God is at all. I've met individuals that say, well, you know, I think I know this about God. They've discovered God on their own, and yet they believe that to the exclusion of everyone else. If you discover who God is outside of the Word of God, you have your own God, but nobody else has Him. I'm just telling you something. He's not that kind of a God. He's the God of the Bible, and I found it to be true. I'm going to tell you something else about God before we get too far along and read our text this morning. God is love. God loves us. You may have heard love redefined in many different ways, but God loves you so much that Jesus, His Son, who is above the highest form of human life. In other words, you take the greatest rank and authority. In Sunday school this morning, we said if Jesus came, and if He came to earth, which He did, as a person, as a human, as a man, and we were to give Him a rank befitting Him, He would be an absolute dictator of the world, wouldn't He? If God is going to become a man, the best position we could give Him would be absolute dictator, and that would still be way, way under what He is as God. You realize He would still be lower than the angels? If He was the greatest on earth, He would be lower than the angels, and He would still be less than God. My friend, God is higher than us, and yet He condescended, and that's not a bad word. He condescended to come to us. And when Jesus Christ came, He not only came as a man, He not only came in human flesh and set aside His power as God, but my friend, He came as a servant of men. And He did so because God loves you. It was God's plan before the foundation of the world for Jesus Christ to come and to make up for that problem of sin that each of us has. And my friend, you can know God's love, and you can know that God not only loved you enough to die for you, but you can know as well that God knows loves you enough to help you live for Him. And so I want to just say that as plainly as I can state it this morning. I want to read a few verses in Hebrews chapter 4 for our text this morning. And we're in the midst of a short series in Hebrews and warning passages. And so I want to read it beginning in verse 7 this morning. And we can't read everything that could be read, but we'll begin reading in verse 7 this morning about this statement that's made in Psalm 95, verses 7 through 11. Again, the Scripture says in verse 7, He limiteth a certain day, saying in David, today, after so long a time, as it is said, today, if ye will hear His voice, harden not your hearts. For if Jesus had given them rest, then would He not afterward have spoken of another day? Verse 9, there remaineth therefore a rest to the people of God, for he that is entered into his rest, he hath also ceased from his own works, as God did from his. Verse 11, let us labor therefore to enter into that rest, lest any man fall after the same example of unbelief. And then let's look at verse 16 as well. Let us therefore come boldly into the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Let's pray and let's ask God to help. We certainly need it. God, this morning there is so much in this passage of Scripture, so much for folks that haven't been here the last couple of weeks to even catch up to where we're at. God, there's so much doctrine, there's so much truth here, and God, so much, it's so interesting and it's so important, it's so relevant that it seems overwhelming to even try to preach out this passage of Scripture in the short time that we have here today. And yet, God, we know that You want to speak to us this morning. We know that You can do things that, of course, humanly speaking, I cannot. And so I ask for the power of Your Spirit this morning as Your Word is preached. And I pray that You would minister to the needs of the hearers. God, for every person that's here today, Lord, I just pray that they would leave this place having learned from Your Word. Lord, for whatever reasons, different ones of us are motivated to be here today. We know that You're at work. We know that You want us to be here. And so we would ask that You would minister this morning and that You would show us needs. God, if there's a person here today that doesn't know Jesus as their Savior, Lord, I pray that need would be understood as well, Father, as fulfilled and met here today. We pray that, and thank You for what You do in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay. I don't know about you, but when you read verses 7 through 9 and you start talking about rest and even the language, would anyone here be honest enough to admit that's a little hard to understand the text today? Would anybody here say, that's a little tough? You know, if you don't admit it, I'm going to ask you to explain it. Okay? So, when you read it this morning, just raise your hand. Is it a little tough? Is the wording? Charlie admitted it. If Charlie can admit it, come on, folks. Let's just, it's group therapy here. It's a little tough passage to read and understand. You say, well, I've studied and I understand that. But do you know that just skimming, perusing, or browsing through Hebrews chapter 4, it's very easy to skip over verses 1 down to, say, verse 11, and then read, for the Word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, and that it is piercing even to the dividing asunder of the soul and spirit and of the joints and marrow, and as a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. I have never heard that verse preached in its context. Now, I've heard it preached accurately about the Word of God and its ability to get to us. Let me just tell you something. Verse 11, or verse 12 is an amazing verse of Scripture. You know that this morning that I can't get to your heart. I can't see what's in your heart. I don't know what motivates you. And I am probably wrong about what I think your motives are. But God can see right into you, and the motives that you don't even know about yourself and the work that is going on in your life that maybe you're not even aware of, God is fully aware of, and He can see right in. And the Bible says the Word of God is able to get into, or it's able to divide between the soul and the spirit. I've never been able to explain, and anybody who thinks that they can explain the difference between the soul and the spirit, anybody who thinks that they can do that is doing more than is humanly possible. Okay, that's something God created. You know, a lot of people try to talk about, and I don't want to get off into stuff that's not interesting to people here this morning. People try to talk about whether we're a dichotomy or a trichotomy, a two-part or a three-part being. You know, I'm talking about body, soul, spirit, you know, or whether we're just a body and a soul, whether our soul and the spirit are the same. And I would say you can write books and you can argue that point up and down. I'll just tell you this, I'm settled understanding that when God created man, He never created him for his body to die. Sin caused that. When man sinned, death passed upon all men. And death is separation. So the body dying and being separated from our soul. And then death being our soul being separated from God. God never intended for us to be separated from God. But can I encourage you this morning? Can I tell you that Jesus Christ settled that separation? Jesus bridged that gap and made it so that we don't have to divide between the soul and the spirit. But the body, the Bible, the Scripture says can divide between the soul and spirit. Let me ask you a question. Can you do that? Can you explain the difference between the soul and the spirit? No, but the Word of God can actually get right into your soul and your spirit and divide in between there and do some mysterious work. I'm telling you, it's a supernatural book. It's an amazing thing. It's an amazing verse of the Scripture. And then it goes on to say it's a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. I have had motives before that I thought were good motives until the Word of God showed me what my actual motive was. You can have a motive behind your false motive. And you think, well, this is why I'm doing what I'm doing. But the honest truth is that there's something going on in your heart that motivates you to do what you're doing. But the motive is altogether different than what you would have to think. You ever thought you were doing a good thing and actually you're doing it for the wrong reason? Well, the Bible's able to show you things like that. God's Word is able to show you things like that. It's a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. We know that verse, don't we? You ever been going through a hard time and you've been told that Jesus knows, Jesus understands? This is a passage of Scripture that's explained. In verse 14, seeing then we have a great high priest that's passed into heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast our profession, for we have not a high priest which cannot be touched with the feeling of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted like we are, as we are, yet without sin. My friend, you may be going through something, and you may think God doesn't understand, and yet God fully understands, because not only did God create the circumstances that you're going through, and not only does God have a good purpose and an outcome and a reason for those circumstances in your life, but God's Son has gone through the same things. He's been tempted by the same things you're tempted. His testing has been the same as your testing. You can't go through something Jesus hasn't already undergone. And so it's a wonderful passage of Scripture. But again, I seldom hear that passage of Scripture preached within its context. Have you? Our context is what we read, not the entire context, but verses beginning verse 7 down to verse to the end of the chapter. Okay, now, then the answer, let us therefore come boldly into the throne of grace that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. We know that verse too, don't we? Most Christians know these verses. We've heard them. We've read them. But the fact of the matter is that we don't think about them within their context. Let's do a little review, and as quickly as I possibly can, I'd like to preach this passage of Scripture. I think, honestly, Christian, if you'll stay engaged for the next 15 to 20 minutes, I think this passage of Scripture will be one of those places that you hold on to. I think it'll be one of those places in the Bible. Just remember, Hebrews chapter 4. If you can't remember Hebrews chapter 4, remember Hebrews, and read your way there, and you can go to it. I think it's one of those places you'll be able to get help for the rest of your life. This is one of those passages of Scripture. It's just so helpful. I believe that it's one of those that can just equip you for life. Now, I know a couple things. First of all, I know it's hot in here. I understand that. I know you're uncomfortable. I know you're hungry. All these things. Maybe some of y'all are hungry. Maybe some of y'all got to fall asleep from your breakfast. But I do know this as well. If you'll pay attention this morning, you'll be helped by it from the Word of God. Not because I'm brilliant, not because I know something nobody else could know, but because this book is amazing and we're going to preach it here. You ready? All right, hang on. Let's go. A couple weeks ago, we began our short series in Hebrews, and we explained to whom the letter was addressed. It's in the title. I love the New Testament of the Scripture. I love the Bible because the titles actually have meaning. I remember learning the books of the Bible and not thinking about what they mean. Genesis. Well, Genesis means beginning. Exodus. Well, Exodus means leaving, exiting Egypt. Leviticus. What's the Levitical law? And so on and so forth. And I remember reading, memorizing those books of the Bible. They meant nothing to me. You know, I just memorized them. I didn't have a... Well, you know, they got those kids back there. It's just not fair. They get to sing songs learning the book of the Bible. Books of the Bible. I had to learn the books of the Bible. No fun in just Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy. I had a hard upbringing as a child. And I'm just joking about it. I was very privileged. I had parents. Okay, I'm not even saying that sarcastically. That's really true. I had loving, great parents. All right, so my jokes sometimes go too far, right? Let's move back. Anyway, the book of the Bible, Hebrews, has a meaning to it. Hebrews. What's a Hebrew? Jew. What's a Hebrews?
To the Jews.
Three Jews. I'm kidding. T-O, the Jews, like the preposition to. Hebrews is a letter that's written to Jewish people, right? All right, so I could ask this morning, it's possible, normally we have some Jewish folks in our service, but I could ask this morning if you're Jewish or not, but the fact of the matter is most of us probably aren't. But the letter of the Hebrews was written to the Jewish people. What were the circumstances that were going on when the letter was written? Persecution. Yeah, the persecution for being Jewish was absolutely terrible. It was horrendous. It was a Holocaust in this day. They were about to, the Hebrews was written around 68 AD, which is about 2 years before 70 AD when Jerusalem was sacked. The temple was burned. That wasn't when the pig was sacrificed, but the temple was sacked. Every stone of the temple torn down, and the Jews were killed. They were enslaved. They were tortured, and they were driven out of Jerusalem. And the Jews weren't allowed to live in Jerusalem anymore. That's when they lost the land. They left the land. And you know, today we have this debate about whether Jews belong in Jerusalem or not. God gave the Jews the land, but 70 AD is when they officially became scattered. See, there had been a remnant of Jerusalem all the time. See, because of their unfaithfulness to God, because they had worshipped idols, and because they hadn't remained faithful to God, God's blessing had in His covenant promises to them had been fulfilled. God said, if you don't worship me, then I'll have you go into exile. And that's exactly what had happened. So they were taken out into the captivity. Babylonian captivity, Assyrian captivity. So the remnant that was at Jerusalem were a small minority, but when Jerusalem was sacked in 70 AD, I'm telling you, it was no longer Jewish. They were driven completely out, and the land was decimated. Nothing left. That's why, you know, a lot of times people ask the question, how come Jews aren't Christians? Well, that's actually not an accurate statement. It's a misnomer. The church began at Jerusalem. But the reason the church is not, you know, majorly big in Jerusalem is all the Christians were driven out of Jerusalem. So the Hebrew Christians were being persecuted because they were Jewish. But the worst persecution actually came from their own family members. Not only were they persecuted because of their ethnicity, they were persecuted by their family for following Jesus. See, at this stage, at this point in time, the church was more Jewish than it was Gentile, and so it was known as a sect of Judaism. But when the believers were driven out of the church, or driven out of Jerusalem, their own families were forsaking them and ostracizing them and driving them out. So not only was it tough to be Jewish, but it was even tougher to be a Jewish Christian. Tell you, if you are a Jewish Christian, the likelihood of you having a job was non-existent. That's why when you see the letters that of the epistles that like Paul would write or Peter would write, and they would talk about the offerings to be taken to the saints in Jerusalem. 1 Corinthians talks pretty specifically about Achaia and Macedonia and how they gave. It's because the saints in Jerusalem literally couldn't make it. If you had a business, and you became a follower of Jesus in Jerusalem, nobody would do business with you anymore. If you were part of a family business and you followed Jesus, your family kicked you out and you didn't have a means of support. It was pretty tough. If you had a loving relationship with your father, he was so under so much pressure from the rabbi of the local synagogue that if he didn't disown you as his son, he'd get kicked out. And literally, your parents, your grandparents, if they wouldn't disown you, they would be cast out. And I mean, what's a guy, you know, a guy gets to be 60, 70 years old and he loses everything. It's a little tougher than a guy who's 20 and loses everything, isn't it true? You know, so say, here's a dad, he comes home and he says, son, I hate to say this, but I can't talk to you anymore. Well, you have a good relationship with your dad. You can't imagine that, but I'm telling you that happened. Can you imagine being a Hebrew Christian? Can you imagine how tough that'd be? Now, I don't know about you all, but some of you would rethink everything if you went through something like that, wouldn't you? If your mom or your dad said, you're no longer my son, I can't talk to you anymore, and I don't want to talk to you anymore, you know, look what you've done to our family, and I hate you, and as far as I'm concerned, you're dead. Can you imagine that? Your friends go by, and they literally hiss at you and spit on you when they go by, and little children despise you and disrespect you. And you just think, man, it's just too much. Just too much. You ever, you know, the proverbial straw that broke the camel's back? You ever, you know, been dealing with things and all of a sudden something happened and that was the thing? Everything else piled up, but that was the thing that just was too much? That's the way the Hebrew Christians were. That's what they were going through. And so this letter that's written to the Hebrews is a letter that's encouraged them to hold on to their faith. Instead of going back on their faith, to hold on to it because it's their only means. Now, we know the end story, don't we? We know 2 years after this letter was written that the Christians who were at Jerusalem had been persecuted by the Jews so much that they were driven out of Jerusalem. They went around the world and preached the gospel and actually became pretty well-to-do. Things actually went pretty well with them. And so when Jerusalem was destroyed, they were actually spared from the sacking of Jerusalem because they've been forced to leave. Well, it's kind of hard to look ahead and see that, isn't it? Kind of hard to know that in advance, isn't it? Sometimes things work out, they seem evil, but they're good. And God was working that. There's some warning passages, there's some reasons why a Christian shouldn't go back on his faith. Some reasons why he shouldn't go back on his faith. Let me just tell you something, this is very different than a cult. You know, you find out whether a religion is cult-like. And by the way, watch out for it in, quote, Christianity. Watch out for churches that preach, hey, if you don't agree with me, you're going to lose your salvation. If you don't agree with me, God's going to, you know, if you leave this church, you watch out for that. And listen, Jesus doesn't need that. I'm going to tell you, the gospel doesn't need that. Truth doesn't have to bully. Truth doesn't have to frighten people. Truth attracts people. And so this letter to the Hebrews is not a frightening letter, but there are warning passages in it. There are warning passages. And by the way, let's go ahead and dispense with the cultural norm of not liking to hear anything negative. You know, negative is bad today. Like, don't ever tell somebody something. If it's true, even if it's helpful, don't tell somebody something negative. It's really sad, actually, kind of, if you think about it, because you can't get better unless you know something's wrong, right? You can't improve something unless you know they're... You know, any person who's wise knows that positive criticism is a good thing, right? But our culture today doesn't like any kind of criticism. Don't tell me that I'm not the best, that I'm not a winner, that I'm not whatever. We were joking this morning about, you know, getting a trophy for eighth place. Bill, you're a sports guy, right? What's an eighth place trophy? I don't mean nothing, right? You're a millennial, aren't you? Yeah, here's a millennial that doesn't care about an eighth place. What's a trophy that means something? What? First place, right? There's an athlete. There's a real athlete. Knows what a trophy actually is. But I was reading, this is in Sunday school, so we're reading about millennials. We're reading about all the generations. But one of the characteristics of millennials is that they got a trophy for eighth place. It's just a description. Is that, you know, everybody's a winner, even if you lose. And, you know, and so we don't want to say anything negative. Tell you, why are you all laughing? Don't be mean to the millennials. Okay? Billy's a millennial. He doesn't believe that. So lump them all in the same, whatever you can. Whatever, I can't think of the words. Sorry about that. Moving forward. Here we have a group of individuals, though, that because of their background, because of their affiliation, their association, they're being persecuted. And they're being warned, and it's a negative warning, but it has a positive outcome. We look at the first warning passage, and it was the warning of if the angels are less than God, if the angels are judged for failing or falling to God, how are we going to escape? In other words, if God judges the angels, how are we going to escape God's judgment if we neglect so great salvation? It's a pretty good warning, isn't it? The warning is if the angels don't escape God's judgment, if God even judges the angels, won't he judge you? You say, Pastor, it's negative, God being a judge. No, my friend, it's a good thing that God is righteous. And if you think it's negative, learn what the word just means. The word just means God is right to adjudicate your judgment. In other words, God judged his son in your place, and therefore he's righteous. And if he's righteous, he has to judge. But he's also righteous to forgive your sin because he judged his son. And so it's a wonderful truth about God. But it started off, the question in chapter 2 was, if the angels are judged, how are we going to escape if we neglect so great salvation? And the answer of how are we going to escape is Jesus. In verse 18 of chapter 2, and that he himself has suffered being tempted. He is able to succor, and then he's to sustain them that are tempted. In other words, Jesus is going to help us escape. Now, friend, the first answer to the first warning passage is, if the angels can't escape God's judgment, how can you and I escape God's judgment? The answer is, we can escape God's judgment, but Jesus will help us. I love what Paul said when he said, I can do all things through Christ, which strengtheneth me. And what the author of Hebrews is saying is, you can make it. Listen, it's hard, it's tough. Let me just tell you something. You think life is tough, but you're in for something. You know what? I think it's going to get a lot tougher, don't you? And I don't think that's negative. I'm not afraid. I'm not afraid for life to get tough because I know that Jesus is able to help me to go through it, and I can make it. And not only can I make it, but I can come forth as gold. And so, Chris, let me just tell you something. You could go back on following Jesus if you're a Hebrew Christian. You could go back to your family and you could cry out against Rome, stand with your family, at least have somebody. At least have somebody around you who actually, you know, wasn't against you, and you could die with them. Or you could stand with Jesus and be persecuted by those people, ostracized by those people, and you could live with Jesus. See, sometimes we think something's negative, but Jesus is able to help him make it. I'll just tell you something, Christian. You're going to go through some hard things in life. There are things that will happen, and by the way, sometimes God's doing something amazing in it. Sometimes it's good. You can't see it when you're going through it. You're not going to be able to look down the road and say, you know what, I know what's going to happen. But you can know this. I know that God's always good. And I know what God does is going to be good. The outcome is going to be great. The outcome for a follower of Jesus, my friend, is always, 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 always wonderful. And that's the answer. How am I going to escape? Well, Jesus is going to help. Then the second warning passage was about Israel. And we went through last week and we talked about the Exodus and how that God used Moses to lead the children of Israel out of Egypt. And when he led the children of Israel, are you sleeping, Mike? Oh man, you tripped me. All right. And when he led the children of Israel out of Egypt, I love kicking Mike's foot. He shows up just so I kick his foot. That's right. When Moses led the children of Israel out of Egypt, they complained against him in the wilderness. How would you like to be an 80-year-old man? Think about this. How would you like to be an 80-year-old man and have God tell you, go and lead people out of Egypt? I'd want to die at 80 if I got called to do that. Let me just tell you, be honest with you. And then while you're with them in the wilderness, God's supplying their needs. He's providing them manna. He's providing them water to drink and quail to eat. Manna and quail, so meat and bread. And they're complaining about it. They're complaining against you as God's leader. God's presence is with you. He's a cloud by day and a pillar of fire by night. God's done all these things, and they're complaining about, how would you like to be Moses? I wouldn't. I wouldn't want Moses' task. I wouldn't want his job. And people talk about Moses' faithfulness. And that's what chapter 3 really talks about. He was faithful in his house. But Jesus was the one who appointed Moses. And the one who appointed Moses is greater than the one who than the one who was appointed by him. Okay, so let's make our point. Last week we saw the warning about how because they complained against God, the children of Israel were told they would not enter into rest. And Canaan was the land of rest. Canaan was a land where they were promised that you will go into houses that you didn't build. You had to go in, there will be a place already built. You'll be able to harvest vineyards that you didn't plant. I mean, that's pretty amazing, isn't it? If you're a farmer, you know that the work is not in harvesting, the work is in planting. That harvest is an intense time, it has to happen fast, but the work is in everything that goes into getting the plants to the harvest. And God said, literally the description of Canaan was, it was a land with milk and honey. It was just a land of great, deep blessing. And here they are in the wilderness, looking forward to that. And because they complained against God, God said, not a single one of you who are of this generation will make it in the land of Canaan, except for two individuals, Joshua and Caleb, who didn't complain, who believed God. And so we were told last week, we were encouraged that you don't have to be part of it. It could be a majority that's against God. You don't have to be part of it. It's always a majority that's wrong. Whenever it's a major group that's doing something, making a decision, you know, hey, everybody's for it, it's probably not a good idea. It's usually wrong. Now, I don't make some kind of rule for government or something from that. But the reality is, when it comes to morality, that's usually the truth. And so the Bible, the description here in Hebrews is kind of graphic. It says their carcasses were left, or they died in the wilderness. They died. They didn't make it into the land of rest. Now today we see an argument, or we see, if you will, a persuasive argument that's written. And the question that is made is whether or not there's a rest for the children of God. So let's look again in verse 4. For he spake in a certain place of the seventh day on this wise, and God did rest the seventh day from all his works. Okay, you see the precedent for rest? The precedent is after 6 days of working, when God created the earth, heaven and the earth, he rested on the seventh day, the Sabbath day. And in verse 6, it says, seeing therefore remaineth that some must enter therein, and they to whom those first preached entered not in because of unbelief. Okay, here's the argument being made in Hebrews. Tune in just for a minute, because we're almost done. The argument is, if the promise of rest was made to the children of Israel, and Canaan was the land of rest, and if God's promise is still made, in other words, if God always keeps, does God always keep his word?
Yes.
Does God ever lie?
No.
Oh, he's God that cannot lie. If God promised a rest, and those to whom rest was promised did not enter into it, has the rest yet been obtained?
No.
And the answer is no. No. See, when the Holy Spirit used David to write Psalm 95, which is being quoted by the Holy Spirit here in Hebrews, it talks about entering into rest, and it's still future tense after the Exodus, after the entering into the land of Canaan. And if that's still a future event, if it was still a future event then, and it was then, it was still a future event in Hebrews. Do you get this? In other words, the Holy Spirit here is making an argument to believers that though they are undergoing certain difficult times, that there is light at the end of the tunnel. That there is a place, that there is a time of rest. And nobody's entered into it yet, so it's a future event. If it's a future event, then it's something they can hope for. It's something they can look for. You know, one of the worst things in the world is not to have hope. When you ask people that are struggling with depression to describe what they're talking about, one of the things that almost universally is said, there's all different types of depression, people battle it. But one of the things almost universally people say is, no hope. No hope. Whereas I don't feel like it's ever going to get any better. I don't feel like there's any good outcome. I don't feel like there's anything to look forward to. The Holy Spirit here in Hebrews is saying, there's a rest. And if you study the Scripture, you understand what that rest is. My friend, it's a time of great hope. It's a time when the toil is over. It's a time when the hardship and the difficulty is in the past. It's a time when the events that you thought were never going to end have ended. It's a time when the reconciliation of problems that you thought couldn't be reconciled are reconciled. It's a place of rest. I don't know about you, but there are certain things that make me appreciate rest more than anything else, right? You want to have a good night's sleep? Now, some people got some medical things going on there, insomniacs and that sort of thing. But I'll tell you what most people's problem is. Most people's problem is that they don't have a regular schedule. And they don't have a hard enough regular schedule. I'll tell you, if I'm having trouble sleeping, there's something I can do that helps me with it. First of all, get up early. If I get up at 4 a.m., I don't usually feel like getting up at 4 a.m. The other night, I woke up at 3:30 and I could not sleep. And I mean, I just had to get up. That doesn't happen to me very often. But if you're having trouble, get up at 4 a.m. And then get yourself a busy, hard schedule and include in it difficult, hard, physical labor and lots of it. And while you're working, work to the point where you feel like you can't work anymore and then continue to work. And while you're continuing to work, promise yourself rest. And you'll be amazed at how much rest will get you through something. How many of y'all like to run? Any runners here? You do? Good for you, Allie. I hate running. I do it, but it's the hardest thing in the world, man. Running people, it's true, isn't it? After you run for a while, it's fun. Yeah, that's weird. All right. Running can be fun, and I've been to that place, that point. I'll tell you, I'm not there now. I'll promise you that. Here's what I do when I'm running. One more step. Right? I start off by, like, I look down. I don't run on a treadmill. Can't really do that very well. But that's why I like to get out and run around. And I like to run at scenic places. Around my house, a lot of lakes and stuff like that. I like to run around lakes. And a lot of times you get a nice breeze. But I pick points, right? Okay, I'm going to run this at this pace. You know, keep my heart at this rate or whatever. Run at this pace until I get to that point down there. I know the distance. And I just run to there. But I'm always lying to myself. I don't know about you, but I get more out of me when I lie to myself. So I'll be like, all you got to do is just run down to there. That's all you got to do. And I make it down there. I'm like, okay, now we're just going to run another to the next stoplight, you know. And I'll have my run is a series of lies, you know. If you make it to there, you can quit. But when I make it to there, and I don't know how, but you believe your own lies. Somehow I believe it, you know. And I just like, if you just keep this pace to there. But I tell you what, when you really have an end to it, you know, you're not just like, well, we're just going to run forever. It's never going to end. But you actually know what your run is. Well, you can run a lot better, can't you? Yeah, Allie, you ever gone out and had somebody run with somebody and tell you how far they're going to run? That's weird, isn't it?
Yeah.
Because you don't know what pace to set, right? You don't know how hard to run. Here you are. You're like, you know, let's pick it up a little. But then maybe they're running a marathon. You know, maybe you don't want to pick it up a little. You know, that's no way to run. You want to know where it ends. You want to know where the rest is, right? So a runner can actually understand rest. If I know I'm running a 5K, I can kind of push myself. I say, well, you know something, I've never died on this, and if I do die, I won't care anymore. So, you know, let's just go ahead and go at it for, you know I can just do it for this long and then just, you know, pass that finish line, pass out, you know, whatever my little, you know, finish line routine is. You know, gag, throw up, die, whatever. But if you know that there's an end to it, you can make it, right? Doesn't that help? You know, a lot of the Hebrew Christians, honestly, they're going through persecution, and it's so tough, and it's so difficult. It seems like every day it gets worse. And the only problem is they just don't see it ever ending. They don't see it ever getting any better. You know, some of you Christians, some of you can relate to that. Maybe you wouldn't tell anybody. Maybe you wouldn't share it with anybody. But what you're going through right now, it just seems like you couldn't even explain it to somebody because they just give you the, you know, the pat answers, right? Oh, you can make it. Oh, you're doing fine. Oh, what? You don't need to hear that. But I'll tell you what you need to hear. Is that God promised a rest. And because God promised a rest, and because they didn't enter into it, it wasn't for them, but it is for you. And that's a great promise. You know, I wanted to tell you something. When I think about it, I don't have any kind of a death wish. I love life, and honestly, I really enjoy life, and I hope I get to do a lot of things before the Lord takes me. But I tell you this, I don't care about dying anymore. I'm not concerned about it. I've realized that eternity is so much better. Being with God, heaven is so much better. And God's future plan, I'm going to live in a perfect world someday, folks. And all the things I enjoy right now, I'm going to enjoy without a sinful nature. I'm going to enjoy without problems. And I'm going to live with perfect people. And I won't be the problem because I'll be perfect too. And I'll just tell you, so I look forward to that. It's going to be really nice. And I'm not going to struggle with wanting to go against what the Bible says is right and wrong because I'm going to want to do right. I'm not going to have a sin nature anymore. And I'm going to be with God. And, you know, we think about this, you know, we're going to, you know, you have these pictures of heaven that are painted, right? You got this little angel floating in a cloud with a harp. I don't want to be an angel on a cloud in a harp. Never have been. You know, Tom Sawyer said when Mrs. Watson used to tell him what heaven was like, he figured he'd rather go to the other place, you know. But when the widow would tell him, this is Huckleberry Finn, he said, when the widow would tell you about heaven, you know, you'd want to go there. And sometimes you wonder what people say about heaven. I think I don't want to go there. But I read the Bible says about heaven. I don't know about you, but this world that God created, even sin cursed, it's a beautiful place. This last week, I drove all the way up to Vermont and drove all the way back down here. So I went way up north. I don't know what, I think I drove like 3,500 miles or something last week. So I drove all the way up there. I went, it's just gorgeous. I drove through the east coast of America. And by the way, everywhere I was probably not more than 20 minutes from a Dunkin' Donuts. Now, for you West Coast folks, I don't know about y'all, but I think I've become an Easterner because, you know, they just don't do coffee on the West Coast. But the East Coast, they got Dunkin' Donuts everywhere. You know, it may be the upcoming trend. This has nothing to do with anything right now. For there to be coffee on the West Coast, and they may pride themselves in all that. But Dunkin' Donuts is better, and the Easterners have it, so I'm an Easterner. And anyway, I was driving along, and I just realized, man, I always realize this. I love everywhere. And I could drive through any, people tell me, oh, you know, this area of the country is so ugly. I don't think so. I think you're just a negative person. I've never been a place that didn't have natural beauty. I can go out to the swamp and it's just beautiful. You can go in the mountains and it's just beautiful. You can go to the ocean, it's beautiful. You can go in the desert, and I'm telling you, there's a rugged beauty there that is just unsurpassed. And God made a beautiful world, but it's sin-cursed. And someday I'm going to live on this earth, my friend, and it's not going to be sin-cursed. Matter of fact, for 1,000 years, Jesus Christ is going to do what man has never done. He's going to actually rule this earth, and he's going to make it perfect. It's going to be absolutely perfect for 1,000 years. And then those individuals who still have a sin nature are going to come out to make war with each other, and they're ultimately going to turn against God. This is Revelation 19. And they're going to war against Jesus. He's going to come, and they're going to unite against God, and God's going to destroy them. And then he's going to destroy the world. He's going to create a new one. It's going to be absolutely perfect. And guess what? They're still going to be fishing. You read it. I'm telling you, it's in the Bible. You read about it. There's going to be fish and there's sea. And, you know, you think about, I've been told, well, we're just going to spend eternity worshiping God. Well, we'll be in a continual state of worship. But there's going to be events where we worship God. And we're going to want to be in those events. But we're actually going to be living. As long as we think we're just going to spend eternity, we're just going to be flat, prone-faced, millions of years worshiping God, I think that's nuts. I mean, I'm not being silly right now. I'm just telling you some of the things I've been told about heaven are just kind of, now I just think, my goodness, you know, I wouldn't want to go to hell, but that doesn't sound like much fun. Get it? You know what I'm saying?
Might be playing football up there.
No, no football. No football. I'm kidding. What do you got to bring football into? Right in the middle of talking about fishing. Mike's gone. He's gone off his rocker. He's just absolutely nuts. Okay, anyway. Baseball, right? Yeah, okay. Plays baseball. Soccer. No soccer.
No soccer.
Now we got controversial about heaven. Man.
It's called football.
What?
It's because it's called football. Thanks. No soccer.
Thanks, Nick. Let's get back on topic. Mike, look what you did. Again. Thank you. Moving forward, these people want to go home. I promise them they could. Right, so now, heaven's going to be a beautiful place, and I want to go there. I'm going to tell you something. Just knowing how good heaven is makes it okay to live here for a while. I mean, it honestly does. Jesus Christ is risen, and I'm alive, and my perspective is completely different because of that. And what the author of the Hebrews is saying in verse 8, he says, if Jesus had given them rest, then would he not afterward have spoken of another day? Now that's not a question, that's a statement, verse 8. You see that? In other words, if they had realized the promise, it wouldn't have been spoken of in Psalm 95. You know that this is another place where the Scripture quotes Scripture and calls it God's Word. Jesus spoke of a day of rest in Psalm 95. Who did he speak by? David. David. And so we know that Psalms are the Scripture. And then it says that in verse 11, here's the therefore. Or verse 9, I'm sorry. There remaineth therefore a rest to the people of God. Christian, I want the message today not to be complicated. I want it to be simple. And I want it to be simply this. There remaineth therefore a rest unto the people of God. In other words, your future is bright. There's a hope. Listen, whatever you're going through, and it may be something that nobody else can relate to. You know, the truth of the matter is sometimes on Wednesday nights I really realize this, sometimes I know something nobody else knows, somebody shared something with me. Somebody will raise their hand, they say, I have an unspoken. I know what the unspoken is. I know what it is. I'm praying for it, they're praying for it. Sometimes I have unspokens. An unspoken is something that's so private that you can't share it with your brothers or sisters. It's something that is such a burden that maybe you couldn't even explain the burden. It's overwhelming. It's just really something. Sometimes that's the way we feel. That's the way we live. I just want to tell you something. It's not the way it's always going to be. Because there remaineth therefore a rest of the people of God. And it's a wonderful thing when somebody says, Pastor, I have an unspoken. I wish you'd pray for me. To think, the day's going to come. The day's going to come when you won't have that burden anymore. The day's going to come when that'll be settled. That'll be satisfied. And God will have taken it away. And everything will be just fine. And that's your future. What a warning. Chapter 4, verse 1 says, "Let us therefore fear, lest a promise being left." In other words, we ought to be afraid that if Israel was the seed of promise, and God led them out of Egypt, and God gave them Moses, and he did all those things, and they still didn't make it in the land of Canaan, we ought to be afraid that we're not going to make it. Well, that's not very encouraging, is it? It's a warning passage. It's affronting. But here, look at the end of it. In verse 11, you're told, "Let us labor, therefore, to enter into that rest, lest any man fall after the same example of unbelief." I don't know about you, but sometimes a bad example is a good example for me. You ever had somebody and they made a bad decision, you thought, "I'm not going to go that route"? I believe what the Bible says about alcohol, wine is a mocker, strong drink is raging, whosoever is a seed, everybody's not wise. I believe what the Bible says. I'm going to tell you something. If I weren't a Christian, I wouldn't touch alcohol. I grew up with people. I grew up with people whose lives were destroyed by it. I just hate it. I just hate it because I've seen what it does to people. I just wouldn't touch it. I don't care if it wouldn't hurt me. I don't care if I'd enjoy it. I hate it because of what it does to people I love. I just hate the stuff. And I can learn from somebody's bad example, right? I don't have to do something to know, hey, that's not a good idea if I see somebody else do it. And unfortunately, the children of Israel wandering in the wilderness were a good example of a bad example. They're a good example of people who had so much. They were called by God's name. They had God's presence. They had a great promise. And yet they never entered into the rest because of unbelief. And you and I can follow that example and say, okay, I don't want to do that. That's no kind of way to live. The outcome of that's, by the way, a long time ago I realized that if nobody's ever done something and never had it come out good, I probably won't be the first. You know what I'm talking about? You can do the wrong thing and think, well, your circumstances are special. And because it's me, you know, it's going to work. No, I'm sorry. You're just like everybody else that thought that they were special and they did the wrong thing and thought it would turn out well. It's not going to work out right. I'm way over time. So the encouragement here is that you can make it. There's a rest for you. Let us therefore labor to enter into rest. And then remember this, verse 15, "We have none high priest which cannot be touched with the feeling of our infirmities." My friend, if you want to find hope, think of this. Hey, the end is in sight. It's worth it. The goal is worth it. What I'm going through is worth it. It's worth making it. But then you can also say, and Jesus is my example. Jesus understands. You know, it'd be one thing if God's telling me to do something he hadn't done. You ever had somebody do that? I've done it before. In my summer interns, they always say, "Pastor, you're a slave driver. You're a cruel taskmaster." And I've had them do stuff. And sometimes, you know, they'll say, "Pastor, it's impossible." And I'll go and I'll do it real easily. And I'm like, man, you know. But then other times I'll try. I'll be like, man, I gave them a job that's not possible. You know, I'm trying to make them do something I couldn't do. God isn't like that. Jesus, my friend, is the reason you can make it. "We have not an high priest which cannot be touched with the filling of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin." The Bible says, "Let us therefore go boldly unto the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy." Now, you know what that word mercy means? Mercy means you ain't good enough, my friend. Mercy means you've fallen, you failed. You don't deserve forgiveness. But mercy means God gives it anyway. That word mercy is one of the most wonderful things. Here you start a passage of Scripture that says, "Let us therefore fear, lest a promise being left of us of entering into rest, any of you should seem to come short of it." And then you think, man, if they all failed, who am I? I'll tell you who you are. You're an individual who has a high priest that knows what you're going through. And the Bible says, let's go to the throne of mercy. Let's go to the throne of grace and receive mercy, that we might find grace to help in time of need. And my friend, the end result is this. You're told, God, well, hi, Evie. You're told that God will help you. And I want to conclude this way today, my friend. There remaineth therefore rest unto the children of God. There is a rest for you, and there is a rest for me. That's God's promise, and it's for you. It's something they didn't claim, so it's something you can claim. Something is for you. That's your future. That's your outcome. And secondly, I want you to know this. You maybe can't make it. You ever just realize, okay, I can't? Sometimes it's one of the best things you can realize, and then you realize, yeah, but Jesus can. I can't, but Jesus can. And I can go to God and I can say, God, I've failed. How many of you could say that? Yeah, me. I'm a failure. God, I'm a failure. But Jesus isn't. and I want mercy. And the Bible says, and find grace to help in time of need. Hey, the more needy you are, the more help there is. It's amazing how many times we think, I don't need anybody. I don't need nothing from nobody. Boy, a person like that can't be helped much. But when a person says, you know, I do need help, God can help them. And you're here this morning, and the difference in your attitude between a person that would say, God, it isn't fair. God, life isn't good. God this, God that, and you're complaining against God, you won't enter into rest. You're here this morning, and you realize, you know what, God, I'll never measure up. I'll never be good enough. I can't be a, you know, church people. I'm talking about church people, those judgmental people that look down on you when you come into church and so forth. I can't measure up to them. They're all a bunch of hypocrites anyway. I can't be that good of a hypocrite, you know, whatever it is. I can't do it. Listen, you can. Thank God for that, but Jesus can. And you're never going to be a good person. Jesus Christ is perfect. You're never going to measure up to that, but Jesus died for your sin, and God made it so that if you receive Jesus, He'll give you the power to become the sons of God. You can't, but Jesus can. And there's a rest. Maybe you're going through something. You're a Christian. You're a child of God. You've received salvation. There's no doubt in your mind that you've trusted Jesus, but yet life circumstances seem so difficult that they're more than you can bear. And I just want to tell you something. They're not more than Jesus can bear. And you can go to God and you can obtain mercy. Whatever it is, God can help. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for what you've taught us from your Word today. And Lord, I pray that Hebrews chapter 4 would be a passage, a portion of the Scripture. Lord, that we would realize there's a rest for us. The children, the seed of promise didn't enter into the rest, but we can. And we can not because we're better than them, not because we hold on, because we try harder. We can because of Jesus. And Lord, we thank Jesus, and we ask you to bless and move in the invitation. Now we pray in His name. Amen. I want to end our service with an invitation this morning. And if you take your blue hymn books, before you stand up, but just take your blue hymn books and open up to page 250. We're going to sing God's Final Call. It's a song we're going to sing. And before we sing it, I would like to explain the invitation this morning. The invitation is a time when we would invite you, if God has spoken your heart and He showed you something, maybe it's just a sweet promise from God, where God just said, you can make it. Maybe God just showed you that this morning. Would you claim that promise? Would you ask God for His help? Would you just say, you know, Jesus, you said I can, so I can. I'm going to believe you. Would you just this morning agree with God, believe Him, take Him at His promise? You're here this morning, and maybe you've never trusted Jesus as your Savior. You don't even know what that means. Maybe you know a little what it means, or you don't, but you don't know it, understand it completely. Friend, this morning, would you just do business with God about that? I have Brother Tosh standing in the back. One of the reasons he's there is he's ready to open a Bible and show you how you can know for sure you have eternal life. You can't make it without Jesus, and in order to have Jesus, you have to receive Him as your Savior. So that's the invitation this morning. Does everybody understand that? Just a time when we invite you to respond. Now, you could just pray. You don't have to come forward. I'm asking you to make a public statement or decision. We're just asking you to do business with God. So maybe while we stand and sing, you can remain seated. Or maybe kneel and pray as God leads. We want you to feel God's freedom in the invitation this morning. Okay, if you're physically able to, would you stand? And we'll sing Final Call. We'll sing it without the piano this morning. We don't have it in here. Page 250. And as we sing, you do business with God. Will you please?
Someday you'll hear God's final call to you to take His offer of salvation true. This could be it, my friend, if you but knew. God's final call, God's final call.
How can you live another day in sin? You can't.
How can you live another day in sin? Thinking someday with Christ you will begin. Oh, will you hear above the world's loud din? God's final call, God's final call.
My friend, the day will come when you and I will not be given future opportunity. This is the day of opportunity. If you're living and you're breathing, that's because God is still working in your life and He's not done with you yet. And if God's spoken to you about something here this morning, and maybe the message has created more questions than it has answers, just know this. We have a Bible and it has the answers. I don't know everything, but But God's Word does, and I can find an answer for anything in God's Word, and we can find that answer together. We're here for you. We'd like to help you with that. You're here this morning, and you don't know for sure that you're born again. You don't know that you've got the matter of your salvation settled. Hey, listen, we've got time. I have time. My wife has time after the service. We could talk to you about it. We could get that matter settled once and for all, and you can be confident that you have eternal life. We have time for that. We'd like to do that. Maybe you're here this morning and there's a burden in your life or something. Maybe it's private. You can't even share what it is. But you'd say, Pastor, I need an answer. And I need to know this from the Word of God. Well, listen, we close the service, but the invitation is never closed. It's never settled. God's not done. It's not working. As long as you're living and you're breathing, you walk out of here today and God is still working in your life and He still can do a work in your life. We want you to know that. We're here for you. We love you. We'd like to be a help. So let's dismiss with a word of prayer. Brother Al, would you please dismiss us?
Thank you, dear Lord, for the opportunity to hear your word this morning. Thank you for the privilege that we enjoy that many others in this world have to fear. But I pray that you would bless this service to our hearts, bless the word, help us to be doers of it, lead our lives this week according to it. I pray in Jesus' name.